On this episode of America's Port, preparing for the arrival of a queen.
A pure sweep prior to the arrival of the Queen Victoria to make sure that there are no explosive devices attached to those pilings.
Customs and Border Protection stop a suspicious container.
Main focus is anti-terrorism and narcotics.
The Port Police dive team takes the lead on a nationwide missing person case.
We're going to be searching one of the marinas in the San Pedro area for a missing person.
Alpha will be able to help solve the case.
The number one container port in the United States.
Los Angeles, California is not just Hollywood beaches and movie stars.
Along with the neighboring port of Long Beach.
We receive 5 million containers here annually.
Where nearly half of all imported goods enter the country.
That's power.
With 14,000 containers arriving by ship daily. Hundreds of trucks and trains transporting their cargo to stores throughout the country. And more than 1 million cruise ship passengers traveling annually. Protecting America's port is a top priority.
It can be very much a terrorist target.
Protecting this port is tough.
Securing this American gateway just might be a matter of life or death.
You ready to go?
The Port of Los Angeles is on high alert for the arrival of a prestigious cruise ship, the Queen Victoria. With thousands of passengers and media hype surrounding her maiden voyage, the Queen Victoria, in counter-terrorist terms, is considered target rich.
The port team's already in the water, so we're just going to go in on the same piling that they're at.
PDOG, the Port Dive Operations Group, has just an hour to complete its mission before the Queen Victoria arrives.
A pier sweep on Pier 93 here prior to the arrival of the Queen Victoria. It's a maiden voyage into the Port of LA, and we're just making sure that the pier is safe, that there's nothing in the way of any harmful devices that could affect the docking of the ship or its safety while it's in port.
When he says harmful devices, he means bombs.
Swim down to the end of that camel for recovery. Your other two are down there already.
Since September 11th, we do periodic searches down here.
Can you give us the port number?
Well, 201, six divers deployed mid-pier. We're part of the Port Dive Operations Group. We're the LAPD team. We're also working with the Port Police team. And our safety divers are from the Los Angeles Fire Department. So we have a total of three teams that are working about 1,200 feet of pier. And the process will take about 45 minutes to make sure that there are no explosive devices or anything else attached to those pilings.
This low visibility water means additional risk to divers.
Of course, it's pitch black down there. Divers are tied into a line for safety reasons and also because it assists with the search. They basically follow the line kind of in a serpentine pattern, and this way, every foot of the piling is covered, going down to a depth of about 35 feet.
We've got four LAPD divers underneath the pier searching the bottom of the dock, and there's two more divers that are searching the camel area that the ship's going to lay alongside when it comes in.
An explosion here could shut down the port.
Side of the camel.
Roger that.
No bombs. The dock is clear.
One, two, three.
Now the bomb sweep moves inside the cruise ship terminal with a canine unit specially trained to sniff out explosives. The dogs find nothing in the terminal. With the counterterrorism sweep complete on land and sea, the port clears the Queen Victoria for entry. The Cunard cruise ship line includes the Queen Mary II and Queen Elizabeth II. And now the Queen Victoria makes her maiden voyage from England to the Port of Los Angeles. Built for $500 million, the Queen Victoria's christening was a national celebration. Only members of the royal family can name Cunard ships. For the Queen Victoria, Prince Charles's new wife, Camilla Bowles, did the honors.
I name the ship Queen Victoria. May God bless her and all who sail in her.
While the captain is entrusted with navigating the half-billion-dollar vessel around the world, he is not allowed to bring the ship into dock. That job belongs to port pilots like Captain Mike Rubino.
Captain's the one that knows his ship the best. We know the port, we're the experts in the maneuvering in the port, and that teamwork allows the ship to pass safely through the harbor without any problems.
It's time to head out. The port pilot boat takes Rubino 3 miles out to meet the Queen for the first time.
It's always fun for me to go on a new ship, especially a ship with the heritage of Cunard Line and their grand cruising ship. She's on her maiden voyage, and for us, that's always fun and interesting.
On the pilot boat, Rubino is joined by two sea marshals. With the pier free of explosives, the next step is to sweep the vessel. She could be the weapon.
Whenever you have a high-profile ship arrive at the Port of Los Angeles, there is a very real risk of terrorism. Our job is to ensure that there aren't any terrorists out here to create problems for the people of Los Angeles.
Right now we're approaching the starboard side, the lee side of the Queen Victoria. So as soon as we get up to the side port, I'll be making my way outside, up the ladder, and onto the bridge.
While both boats are still moving, Rubino climbs a rope ladder to board the ship.
Morning. Good morning, sir. Welcome on board.
Welcome. Thank you.
As Rubino heads up to the bridge to take the con, or control of the ocean liner, Diaz and his partner begin the sweep.
C-85 information only. We have one C unit on the bridge and one C unit doing a walk around on the Queen Victoria.
Nearly 1,000 feet long, the Queen Victoria has 12 decks and 990 staterooms. These sea marshals have a lot of ground to cover at sea.
Our duties include surveying the ship for any oncoming threats. We want to make sure that there are no vessels approaching the ship in any form. As you can see, we have our police boats also doing perimeter patrols of the area. The other set of blinking lights over on our port side is a Coast Guard vessel that's providing a security escort into the Port of Los Angeles.
Diaz knows firsthand the importance of tight security.
Doing this type of work is very meaningful for me because during 9/11, I was a police officer in the city of New York during the time that the attacks occurred. And so I'm still continuing to fight terrorism.
Surrounded by security, the Queen Victoria approaches the port's entrance.
It's the famous Angel's Gate Lighthouse, right here. Welcome to the Port of Los Angeles, folks.
As the Queen Victoria enters port, Diaz continues to scan the water for danger. Always vigilant for a USS Cole type of attack by a small vessel.
We always anticipate the possibility of a ship lying out here in the darkness with their lights off. And so We watch this area very carefully.
All right, let's see what's going on up at the bridge.
On the bridge, veteran port pilot Mike Rubino maneuvers the 90,000-ton vessel through an obstacle-ridden bay, navigating speed as he goes.
Speed limit in the Outer Harbor is 10 knots. When we get to reservation point, it drops down to 6 knots. It's a short run, but it's a run that has a lot of maneuvering in it. It's a lot of communications, a lot of traffic. So you're always on your toes until the ship's safely alongside the dock and made fast.
Rubino pilots her safely into her parking spot on the pier.
Roger. The police boats have just radioed that the ship is safely in its dock.
The ship performed flawlessly, and we're alongside.
Okay.
All right. Very good.
This transit was safe, but the terrorist threat remains.
If the port of Los Angeles were to be attacked, it would seriously affect commerce in the United States. It's a critical location, and we need to protect it.
At 7 a.m., the Queen Victoria's World Travelers exit the liner. Inside the cruise ship terminal, port police continue the next phase of the terrorist sweep. Luggage.
This is where it's most like an airport, where there's thousands of people trying to get on and thousands of people trying to get off. So, and if there's any potential for terrorism, it would be during this critical time, because there's always people confined in a small space. If my dog finds an explosive device, hey, good, we save lives, that's fine. But I could go my whole career without finding one. Hey, I'll just be just as happy.
But cruise ships are only one way terrorists could smuggle explosives into the U.S. With thousands of cargo containers arriving here daily, physically searching them all would be impossible, according to former Secret Service agent Paul Lipscomb.
There isn't a 100% check. If in fact we did a 100% check, we would bring the economy of this port to its knees and stop economic way of life throughout the United States. The impact would be unbelievable.
If the Port of Los Angeles shut down, the American economy would suffer a massive blow. Store shelves would sit empty. The cost would be a staggering $1 billion a day. Securing this open port with its constant flood of cargo is a unique challenge.
Protecting this port is tough. It's not like an airport where I can put a fence around an airport. I can put security devices. I can put cameras and alarms, etc. I can't do that here.
Protecting 43 miles of coastline that can't be fenced in is the responsibility of the Port Police.
LA Port Police, anybody aboard?
With assistance from the Sheriff's Department, LAPD, Customs and Border Protection, and the Coast Guard. Executive Director Dr. Geraldine Netz makes securing the port a top priority.
You're always looking at ways to enhance security, and there's always new things that people can think of that, you know, to try on you, and you have to keep up with those kinds of things. So security is never done. We're always working on security.
In today's world, we have to maintain a vigilance so that if an event occurs, we're there to stop it.
Today, Customs and Border Protection officers red flag a suspicious container.
We'll look for weapons, we'll look for money. We actually will look for everything.
At the Port of Los Angeles, trucking is a major part of the engine that moves goods from ship to shore. Truck driver Sal Orozco deals with the problems of being a longtime short-haul trucker.
I've been driving for this company 17 years. Trucks right now, you make money, but you got a lot of expenses to pay. And competition is out there, and more trucks, less pay.
And longer waits at the port security checkpoint. Though he works for a trucking line, the truck he drives is his own. All day long, he transports full containers from the port to a distribution center about 10 miles from the harbor.
So where do you want me to go?
Pull that one to the yard.
And returns the empty cans to the port. Soon, Orozco will have more to worry about than competition from other truck drivers. There's a new regulation at the port, the Dirty Truck Ban. Its aim, reduce port pollution by 80% over the next 5 years.
A lot of the trucks that come into our port are really old, beat-up trucks.
Leading the charge against pollution-spewing vehicles is the port's executive director, Dr. Geraldine Natz.
Those old trucks really generate a lot of air emissions. So in October 2008, any truck that was built before 1989 can't come in.
That means soon, Orozco's 1989 so-called dirty truck will be phased out. He too will be turned away at the port entrance. In an effort to offset some of the 17,000 metric tons of carbon dioxide spewed into the air at the port every year.
And then by January 1st, 2012, all the trucks that come in here have to meet the 2007 EPA standard for air emissions. Otherwise, the truck doesn't get in.
The first phase of the ban affects approximately 3,000 drivers of the oldest, dirtiest trucks. That includes Orozco.
That's a good idea to just clean the environment, the clean air, and all the pollution. But it's going to affect us, the one we're driving down. Dirty trucks, because we don't have that kind of money to spend on a new truck. And I don't know what's going to happen.
Before Orozco or any trucker can leave the port with a container, its contents must be cleared by Customs and Border Protection, also known as CBP.
Since we receive nearly half of all international containers that enter the United States, we have a full suite of technology deployed throughout the port. We have radiation portal monitors, so every container coming into the United States is screened for nuclear and radiological emissions.
Items in every container are entered into a Customs and Border Protection database.
Our automated targeting system looks at various relationships between the shipper, consignee, the specific routing in the container, and all that information goes through various algorithms. And if the system does score it over a specific threshold, then we will set it up for a security examination.
The non-intrusive inspection system is a large-scale version of an airport luggage scanner.
This is a high-energy X-ray system, so it produces anywhere from 3.8 to 4.2 million electron volts.
Officers are looking for bombs, drugs, and weapons.
This is one of 8 systems in our inventory, and it gives us a high-quality, high-resolution image on exactly what is in the container.
Customs and Border Protection Officer Ryan Whitehead correlates data from the computer system, a shipping manifest, and the image on the screen. Discrepancies could mean the cargo is concealing illegal weapons, drugs, or worse, a weapon of mass destruction.
We've found weapons. We've scanned vehicles that we find machine gun parts in. You can see the barrel and the trigger assembly. And on an X-ray, you can't tell 100% what something is. So any doubt in our minds, we open the container up and look at the commodity that's inside. This container here that we scan, it's manifested as metal minerals from Panama. Panama is a high-risk country for narcotics. We'll open this up and we'll verify that it is what it is. We're gonna tailgate the third can.
Okay.
We're gonna verify the commodity on it.
All right.
It's metal and minerals. We're gonna open it up, look inside, make sure there's nothing in the middle. We're looking for narcotics, but we actually will look for everything. We'll look for weapons, we'll look for money. standing here, another thing I just noticed, when we were in our manifest, it said the product was coming from Panama. It says product of Peru. So why would they say it's from Panama, but it's actually from Peru? My experience tells me that there's narcotics and stuff getting shipped from Peru.
This cargo is now classified dangerous. The bags could house narcotics or explosives. CBP quickly moves it to a secure location for a closer look. While Customs and Border Protection secures cargo on land, the Port Police dive team takes to the water.
Go!
In the bay, under boats, ships, and docks, the elite 15-man crew searches for weapons, explosives, and illegal contraband. Anything a terrorist could use to derail the port's flow of goods. They also execute search and rescue missions. After a grueling search yesterday, Officer Dave Clements and Sergeant Ralph Edwards found the lifeless body of a man near a dock.
By us locating that person, missing person, I feel we kind of gave the family closure. Although it wasn't the answer they were hoping for, it's still, they were now able to close that chapter and say that, you know, he's been located and he's now hopefully in a better place.
The long mission earned the team much needed family time. For the two officers, it's a welcome break from crime and death.
Hold them up, who's got the biggest muscles?
You.
I do? I'm the winner?
No, not Uncle Dave. You do.
Edwards and Clements are not just members of the dive team. They are family.
I'm married to his sister.
Okay, guess which one's me?
That one. Bye.
Ralph and I have known each other for a long time, years and years and years. So, you know, on top of the whole work dynamic, there's also a bond from family.
All I can say is I hope he can swim.
Lieutenant Michael Graychick is their dive team commander.
Well, Dave and Ralph have a unique relationship. They are related, but they do work well together. They spend a lot of time together on duty and off duty.
But family time is cut short by a call from the dive house. It's the case of a missing 19-year-old that has made national news. Donna Jo went out with a man she met on Craigslist and hasn't been seen since. The man owns a boat in the port marina. The port police get a tip that her body may have been dumped there. Sergeant Ralph Edwards, Officer Dave Clements, and the rest of the port police team gear up for their next mission. In the summer of 2007, 19-year-old Donna Jo was last seen with a man she met on Craigslist. She's been missing ever since and presumed dead. The suspect in the case is John Burgess, a convicted sex offender who owns a boat in a port marina. The port police get a tip that the body of Donna Jo might have been dumped here. A mission with such national impact calls for multiple law enforcement agencies, all under the direction of the Port Police Dive Team.
And we've joined forces with LAPD, and we're going to be searching one of the marinas in the San Pedro area for a missing person.
It'll probably be a long day.
The teams converge at the south end of the marina.
The area we're searching today is pretty large, and we're using some technology like sonar, and we're also using cadaver canine. So we have a canine from the coroner's department, and we have a canine from the LA Sheriff's Department out here with us today, and we're going to be running the cadaver dogs around over the possible area, and we're hoping that we're going to get lucky.
Officer Clements lays out the grid pattern they will use to meticulously search the marina.
If we work along the docks, we can use a reference of the docks. If we move, when we move out, we're going to drop floats to grid it off.
All right, cool.
All right.
So it's a pretty big operation. Hopefully, we'll be able to help solve the case.
Mm-hmm. The grid search starts at the suspect's boat.
All my lines clear, Cuevas.
Edwards' team drops sonar.
Okay, Keen, let it go in the water. Just hold it up by the cord now. Drop it.
Okay, let it down. There you go.
It's on the bottom? Sonar is good for IDing targets. It's not going to give you 100% definition on what exactly you're looking for. Bodies can be concealed in a lot of things, from drums, cans, crates, all that kind of stuff. So it's effective, but it's not conclusive. You actually need eyes on it to confirm or disregard that target.
Divers go in to look for the missing college student. Cadaver dogs sniff the surface to aid in the search.
What he's smelling for is when a body decomposes the gases, the bubbles will come up and they'll sit on the surface. And that's what he'll smell.
What's his indication of a hit?
He'll start barking. You'll know.
After 8 hours of combing the marina floor inch by inch, the exhausted teams yield to fading daylight.
Anytime you're dealing with potential evidence subsurface, it becomes very labor intensive. There's time restrictions for divers, and you burn through resources pretty fast.
No sign of Donna Jo's body. With half the grid left to search tomorrow, hope remains.
There's still a lot of searching left to do, but we're definitely making progress.
Five hours after docking the Queen Victoria, port pilot Captain Michael Rubino heads up the hill to San Pedro to celebrate Thanksgiving with his family.
We've got three generations of Rubinos, and we're happy that you could be a part of it.
Michael Jr. will soon graduate from Cal Maritime, the same Merchant Marine Academy his father attended.
I'm in the Marine Transportation Program, so that's just cargo and navigation.
Rubino gives orders in the kitchen as he does on vessels.
Steady. Hold on. Put her down. Set her down. I saw something come out. We got super tankers in, but we can't get a 20-pound bird from the pan to the cutting board. He's going to carve his turkey. So that's the new tradition, the next generation.
There you go. Okay, here you go.
This is the first year of the next capacity. Still a rookie.
Good job, good job.
Michael Jr. will soon share more than just the carving knife with his father. They'll share the sea.
Ultimate goal is to follow in Dad's footsteps and become a pilot.
Yeah, I'm extremely proud of him, and I'm extremely proud of not only following in my footsteps, but how well he's done doing it. We'll see where his career goes from there, but extremely proud of him.
Tomorrow, Rubino will take his son to work with him as he pilots a mega ship into the harbor. This will be young Michael's last boarding with his dad before graduating as a third mate.
I love that moon. Look at that. That is so awesome.
Customs and Border Protection officers have seized a Panamanian container with questionable cargo. Potentially dangerous, they bring it to a high-security warehouse. Here, they will poke it, prod it, scan it, and test it to ensure it's safe for entry into the U.S.
The main focus is anti-terrorism and narcotics.
The search begins with the canine unit.
He's a specialized narcotics dog. He can detect marijuana, hashish,
and he's always ready to work, too, as you can see.
It's almost impossible to hide the odor from the dog. Their nose is about 400 times more sensitive than yours.
Find it, buddy.
Good boy. He just did a quick run through for me and told me there was nothing in there on the top.
The next step is to unload the container.
The potential for finding a weapon of mass destruction or something that could cause great bodily harm is always a concern.
To prepare for a physical search, the bags are scanned for nuclear radiation.
This is a radiological isotope identifier. If there's a high enough threshold, it will sound off.
Negative. It's time to open the bags.
All right, we got some metal here from Peru, loaded in Panama, referred by the field team, very dense commodity. I want everybody to team up on a pallet and probe it.
So a bag like this could easily conceal kilo upon kilo, little packages. They'll go in with the probe in the bags and then feel around with the probes to see if they can find any dissimilar feels in the contents. It's very effective.
Yeah, if there was a brick of narcotics in there, I'd probably run into it and it would stop the probe. But right now, it's just going straight through to the bottom everywhere I'm probing. It's all right.
One final test remains.
The commodity is iron ore. We're just going to make sure it is what it is. We're going to make sure it's not any narcotics involved. I'm going to grab a little bit of this and put this into this reagent test kit here to make sure there's no narcotics.
Iron ore in its powder form is used in magnets, auto parts, and for scientific research. But it is not Peru's primary export.
It is well known that they've been using products like this as vehicles for smuggling cocaine. And we just want to make sure that there is none in there. Hopefully, if it is here, we will detect it.
You can see there's no color change, so we say this is a negative test.
This product here is what it's said to be. I'm pretty sure that everything here is legitimate. This commodity will be released and go on down the road and become whatever it's scheduled to become.
The container is cleared for transit. In a nearby marina, Port Police divers continue their underwater search for the body of a missing 19-year-old. It's the day after Thanksgiving. Port pilot Michael Rubino brings his son, Michael Jr., to work with him. They wait to climb aboard an overdue freighter from Denmark.
The Sorrel Merce original ETA was 1,500. She's delayed now to 1,700.
Things have come a long way since Rubino Sr. started piloting ships.
When I started here 20 years ago, everything was done by radio. Now there's satellite navigation. There's all kinds of different forms of communication, and we have a pretty good idea if a ship's going to be delayed.
Satellite technology confirms the ship is delayed 2 hours.
It really is not going to change our plans that much. You learn in this business to be flexible. So we'll eat our turkey leftovers a little later tonight, that's all.
Houston, outbound Los Angeles, be at the gate in about 15 minutes. Ship is westbound on its departure.
There she is. The Rubinos board the port pilot boat and head out to intercept the Sorrel Merce in choppy waters.
Hazardous boarding and putting pilots on and off ships out here. The sea's kind of mound up and the ship can get blown around pretty good, so it does create hazardous conditions.
Sorrel Merce, this is LA pilot.
The Sorrel Mercer is one of the largest container ships in the world. She's 10 stories wide, over 10 stories high, and over 100 stories long. So it's like driving a skyscraper laid on side through the water.
The Rabinos must jump from the bow to the swaying Jacob's ladder, 50 feet of plank and rope, which pilots climb to board ships while both are moving. Dead ahead is the most dangerous part of the job.
Yeah, this is the hardest part, climbing up the ladder.
Trucks drive the port's economy. Soon, a dirty truck ban will save lungs and lives, but may kill livelihoods.
The port, they don't want all dirty trucks. In 6 more months, I'm not driving this truck anymore. I don't know what to do. Probably look for something else.
Ban or no ban, he's got a family to feed. The trucking company Orozco works for will soon put 71 liquefied natural gas or LNG trucks on the road, thanks to port subsidized funding. But there's a catch. They must take one dirty truck off the road for each new $200,000 LNG vehicle they add. He can't afford to buy an LNG truck of his own.
I would like to have one of those trucks too, because, you know, it's better for everybody.
For Orozco and thousands like him, the future is uncertain. Day two in the search for the body of the missing 19-year-old Donna Jo.
Hey, there's divers in the water
over
there. Yeah, I see him.
After searching the first half of the grid yesterday, divers found nothing. Officer Dave Clements and Sergeant Ralph Edwards of the Port Police Dive Team lead law enforcement into the second half of the grid.
All right, what's going to happen is we're going to work north from here. Basically, what we want to do is that same width of water column that we've been searching, we're just going to roll that over to the north. How copy on that?
Roger.
When they finish on their this pass, we'll change out the divers so that we can get them out.
Cadaver dogs sniff for the scent of a decomposing body below. They find metal debris, beer cans, a brick, but no Donna Jo.
This right here is
something to look at.
Near a dock, sonar hits a significant target.
It's casting a pretty good shadow, which means it's up off the bottom.
Okay.
For every item that's down there that could be within the size limit we're looking for, it's worth checking out.
Could this be the body of the missing college student? They're going in to find out. The search for the body of missing 19-year-old Donna Jo intensifies.
Okay, start letting it down.
Sonar indicates a mass on the bottom large enough to be a person. And cadaver dogs hit on a scent. Could the body of the missing college student lie below? Divers find a barrel on the marine floor.
It's only about 15 feet deep.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
They tie it off. Topside officers pull it to the surface.
there's nothing inside of it.
For the Port Police dive team, finding nothing is a bittersweet ending.
You get satisfaction out of being able to complete your task, but if I make it a career without finding something, I'll be more than satisfied.
Port pilot Michael Rubino and his son are about to execute the most dangerous part of Dad's job, boarding a moving freighter.
Yeah, this is the hardest part, climbing up the ladder.
The dangling 50 feet of rope and plank is the only way aboard.
I think it's great coming out here and getting to go on the vessels with them. It's exciting every time I get to go on.
A fall from the moving ropes could leave him pinned between vessels or sucked under the ship. Accidents that claimed four pilots' lives last year. It's Captain Rubino's turn.
Okay, well, I guess I'll see you guys later. Thanks.
With 7,000 climbs behind him, this veteran port pilot knows the ropes.
Hello. Thank you.
Hello, pilot. Thank you. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Good, good.
But the climb is only halfway over. A shipmate escorts Rubino up many flights of stairs where he takes command of the gigantic vessel.
Am I looking a little winded? Yeah, it's getting harder and harder to go up that ladder. I don't know why. Those ladders have gotten longer.
Hello, Captain.
How are you?
Good, thank you.
Good evening, thanks, Captain. How are you? Name. Welcome.
How are you?
Captain Rubino is my name.
All right.
This is Cadet Rubino.
Yes.
He's observing today.
Okay.
No relation.
No relation.
No, he's my son. It's slow ahead, 005. Thank you, Kip. How was the trip?
Terrible.
The ship encountered a huge delay due to a weather front en route from Denmark, adding 150 miles to the journey.
LA traffic, Soro Merce.
Soro Merce, traffic.
Good evening, pilots aboard, inbound Los Angeles.
To navigate through the channel and avoid any obstacles, Rubino gets assistance from the tugboat scout.
Scout's all fast back here, Captain Rubino, running with you, sir.
Scout, all fast, roger. If you cut her back a bit, just follow me up. Yeah, Cap, I'm gonna hold up out here, cut her back for you. Come on ahead, I'll follow you up. Steady. Thank you.
Not really much of a difference between on the ship and at home. It just stands around and tells people what to do.
Vessels entering port customarily stay between a green buoy on the left, or port side, and a red buoy on the right, or starboard side. Rubino's intimate knowledge of the channels leads him to push the boundaries of conventional navigation.
We go east of the channel because on these size ships, we have such a short run to the next turn, it sets us up better, gives us a better angle to make this right-hand turn that we're making right now.
This trip is a learning experience for Michael Jr.
I see those green and red buoys and I think, okay, we're supposed to go directly between them, but I think it's interesting how the pilots know that we're able to come to the east of that to shape up better for the channel that we're going into.
On a ship that's 350 meters, you want to gain every advantage that you can while you're maneuvering. And that's just one of them. Scout, stop. Let's take her in, Cap, put you over on the port quarter. Port quarter.
Roger, ship to port quarter.
Roger, Scout.
Any opportunities I can have to come out here and ride along with my dad is great experience.
This job, I think, creates a little humility in all of us when we do it. Just moving these massive ships around this harbor. Today I had my son Michael with me, and it's a very special day. In the spring, he'll be graduating from the Maritime Academy. He'll have his third mate's license and his diploma. I remember this child when he was 5 years old and a toddler, and he looked up to me, and now I'm kind of looking up to him, and he's done a great job, and I'm real proud of him.
As a father and son bond over their love of the sea, a daughter remains missing, some fear in a deep, watery grave, The suspect, sent to prison on an unrelated conviction, claims to have information on where her body is, but won't talk unless given immunity. And due to the dirty truck ban, a family man may lose his livelihood for the sake of cleaner air in the harbor. These are the human dramas that churn through the waters of America's port.